Welcome back to Series 3 of the Atari ST Nostalgia Gave a Basic Tour. In the last few videos, we created some nice animations by buffering and swapping screens and some clever memory manipulations. But we also saw that none of them was actually fast enough to animate the whole screen smoothly. But in this video, we are going to do some smooth full screen movements. And I will show this by starting with the animation from part 27 that we later also tried with B-Move in part 31. And in the end, what we read of it... it's creating the screens. What we ended up with was this animation, which, yeah, it sort of looks like it's a lot smoother than if I tried to move the big circles around, but it was still a bit jerky. And we concluded that B move was not the solution to do full screen animations. However, this is the solution to do full screen animation. So how do we do this? I mean, we can see the animation going at 60 frames per second, and that's only because I sync my emulator with my capture software. On a real ST, this would easily run at 72 frames per second, and it will take hardly any CPU at all. So how do we do this? How do we get this so smooth? And I will just go through the code very quickly with you. And basically, the pre-draw procedure is actually just drawing the big circle, and I'm still using the get and put commands to prepare all the screens, because there was no need to change it. And then I'm going to draw the canvas and actually move that canvas to 20 screens in my graph buffer. So from step 0 to 19, I'm going to move it from my buffer screen to a graph buffer that I made called cycle screen. And for every count, I'm going to shift it by 32,000 bytes, which basically means I have 20 screens in my graph buffer, which also means my graph buffer is actually quite big. And I can show you quickly in general preparations. My program itself is actually only needing 32 kilobytes, and it needs even less, but I only deserve 32 kilobytes. So I could allocate this 640 kilobytes for my graph buffer. So again, I'm reserving less to be able to allocate more. Remember that statement from part 30. And after I've done this pre-drawing and put all the canvases there, basically I'm going to say to my procedure, like go to my cycle screen, but in steps of 32,000. So for every step of I go one screen further, and then plot these six balls with the 60 degree difference between them, as I showed in part 27. And after every step, I'm also going to do an RC copy. And basically, I'm going to copy part of the background from my buffer screen to my physical screen, which I can do because it's not a graphics command. So I'm using the freedom of the RC copy command that it gives me to copy a small tile, which in this case is part of the background and an Atari logo, to my physical screen at a certain position, and that creates the progress bar we saw. And remember, my graphics commands I could not use for this because my graphics commands are actually writing in the cycle screen, as you see here. But because I leave my physical screen unaltered, I can just use RC copy to copy from anywhere to anywhere, and in this case from my buffer screen, which I'm not writing to with my graphics commands, to my physical screen, where I'm also not writing with my graphics commands. So that's just a small example of the freedom that the RC copy commands give me. It's not just for moving objects around on screen, but you can use it for that kind of stuff as well. And of course, the B-moved loop we already saw, which was basically moving the whole screen to my logical screen, to my my view screen in this case, and that takes a lot of time. But as we learned when we did the performance tuning in part 32. We focused on making sure we do as little moving of bytes as possible. So instead of moving the full screen of graphics to where the shifter is watching, it's much better to just tell the shifter to actually look where the graphics already are. And that is what the shifter loop is doing. And basically, it's telling like, leave my graphics screen unaltered, but my view screen, so the physical screen, should actually alter it based on these parameters. And that's how the animation got so smooth. And that is basically the principle of pre-shifting. I do not create my animations in real time. I just store the steps of my animation somewhere in memory. And then I tell my shifter to look at that location in memory, because that's nearly instant. It's like it takes no time at all, and it also takes no CPU time at all. Which means I can do these really big, smooth animations. And this is also what many old school demos did. They created the illusion of moving or distorting a really big object. And it was not calculated in real time. Many demos were really just pointing to 16 copies of pre-shifted data. And it works, so yeah, why not do it? And of course, the interesting thing about this, and that's the main part of this video, is if we can do it for animations, maybe we can use it for scrolling as well. Because in part 31, We saw that B move is actually too slow for proper vertical scrolling. You can lose it for like 2 pixels maximum, and it already gets a bit jerky. So what happens when we use this method again? And I'm going to load my code, and then I'm first going to go to explain a little bit, because the pre-shifting for scrolling is actually pretty easy. What you can do is actually you can draw some screens, and in this case I will use 2 screens, and instead of moving the screen, I can just tell my shifter to move a little bit lower. So in this case, it's looking at the top of the screen, and then the next step, instead of moving these screens, I'm actually telling the shifter to look a little bit lower, and do it in multiple steps. So whenever the shifter gets is looking lower, so the screen of the shifter is actually lower in this 2 screen part, which creates the illusion that the actual screen is actually scrolling up. And that's exactly what the code I wrote is going to do. So like here, I am doing a pre-draw, which basically draws 2 screens, and it draws a contrast by doing a bunch of lines, and then it moves them one after the other into the memory, and like you just saw on the slide that I showed. And then I'm going to do a scroll procedure, which basically says I'm going to count from 0 to the end of the screen. And in this case, very naively in steps of 80, because why not? If I can do a single pixel scrolling, then I'm going to do a vsync and then tell the shifter to actually look at the address like the start of the scroll screen plus this shift. And many of you will probably know that this is not going to work, but I'm going to run the program anyway just to see what happens. Because if I run the program now, and the pre-drawing takes some time, so be patient. But now this happens, and this does not look good. And that's a bit of a pity, but it's also quite logical with the knowledge we already have. Because what we have learned in part 29 already is that the ST shifter can only look at the start address of the screen that is a multiple of 256. So this number, this scroll screen plus the scroll, has to be a number a multiple of 256. And I know this one already is, because I took care of that, which basically means the step that I can take, it has to be a multiple of 256. And to be able to scroll vertically, this also has to be a multiple of 80. And the lowest number that we can use for that complies to both of these conditions, is actually the number 1280, which in monochrome means 16 pixels. And I can show you that, yes, it works after the pre-drawing finishes, which takes some time. And now, yeah, we can see it does vertical scrolling. And it's actually still really, really smooth. The movement is just, it's a little bit too fast, or it's actually way too fast for comfort. This is 16 pixels at a time. In color, it would be 8 pixels at a time, which still would be a little bit too fast. But I want to do more like 4 or 2 pixels, which is actually, would be more suitable for some demo you write, or maybe some game you want to make. And how do we go about this? Now, remember, we talked about pre-shifting. And the pre-shifting can shift a screen, but also I can prepare multiple screens with different steps of the animation, like we saw in the example before that. And to show this principle, I want to first do a visualization again, because I can't shift my screen by 4 lines, but I can create screens that actually have the shift in them already. And in my example, so instead of doing this in 16 lines, I will have, in this case, I will do an example for 8 pixels, because otherwise I need too many slides to make. And to have an 8-pixel scroller, what I could do is I create the 2 screens like I did before, but next to that, I create 2 extra screens, and those screens, the graphics are actually shifted by 8 pixels. And it's a little bit difficult to look and to show in the video, but actually at the bottom of the right of the screen, you can see that the one on the right, the scroll set on the right, is actually shifted by 8 pixels. So what I can do is I can first look at the top of my first set, and then for the second step, instead of trying to shift down, I actually look at the top of my second set. And because the graphics are shifted by 8 pixels, it looks like the screen shifted 8 pixels up. And then for the next step, in this case, I can go back to my first screen, because I'm now at a shift of 16 pixels. So I take a look at my first scroll set, but 16 pixels down. And then I go to the next screen with a shift of 24 pixels. But basically it's 16 pixels down in the screen, but because the graphics are also shifted by 8 pixels, it looks like it's shifted by 24 pixels. So this pre-shifting and switching between the 2 scroll sets creates the illusion that the screen is actually scrolling 8 pixels at a time instead of 4. And you can also see that because I'm shifting down with my shifter, it's reading 400 lines, which means in this case, the last 16 lines of that screen are actually the 16 lines of the next screen in this scroll set. So that's why I need a screen at the end. If I have one full screen to scroll, I need one screen at the end. If I would have a pattern of two full screens, I would need three screens in total per scroll set. We can make lots of stuff in memory. This takes a lot of memory, but yeah, we have a lot of memory, so why not use it? And of course, the smaller the step, the more we need. So for one screen of scroll data, we need two screens for 16 pixels. For an 8-pixel scroller, we need four screens, so two scroll sets of two. And for 4-pixel scrolling, we actually need four sets of two screens, which means eight screens of data. And in my example, in my code, I have to load it, I think, still. I will load some example code for a 4-pixel scroller. And basically, first I'm going to do some pre-draw, which is basically exactly the same as the previous one. So this is exactly the same. I'm creating this canvas and moving it to the first scroll set, so the first two screens. And what I'm then going to do is I'm going to fill the rest of the scroll buffer. And how I'm going to do that is also using the bmove command. I'm doing three steps, and I'm looking at my scroll screen, so the original screen I created in the pre-draw procedure. But I'm going to shift the source address by 320 bytes, so four lines times the step. So the first screen will be 4 pixels shifted, then 8 pixels, then 12 pixels shifted. And I'm going to move that to the top of the next scroll set. So my scroll screen shifted by 64,000 bytes because it's two screens per set. And I'm, of course, the length will be 64,000 minus the shift I'm copying. And then, of course, what I have to do is I have to take the top of my scroll screen and actually move it to the bottom of my scroll screen. So 64,000 minus this step and those bytes, so that's 4, 8, or 12 pixels. I'm going to move to the bottom of the screen. So basically what we saw in the example, in this example here, you can see that on the left side, the top pixels of the original screen are actually at the bottom of the second set, of the second scroll set, the second 8 pixels. I know it's a little bit difficult maybe to see in a video, but that's basically what this procedure does. And after that all is done, I can start scrolling. And first I'm going to just check the scroll screen. So I wrote this procedure basically to go in steps of 64,000. And basically look at the top of each scroll set. So there are four scroll sets here, and each of them should be shifted by 4 pixels. And that's the first thing I want to show. And again, the pre-drawing takes a lot of time because I'm drawing lots of lines in graph mode 3. So be patient, please. But you can see now I'm looking, alternating at the top screen of every scroll set. So it's 1, 2, 3, and 4. And 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And of course, this is going very slow, so you can see, but it looks like I'm shifting the screen up 4 pixels, but I'm really just looking at the first 32,000 bytes of each of the four scroll sets in sequence. And yeah, that works. So all we have to do now is actually make sure that the scroll itself is working. So I'm going to mark out this one, and yeah, I'm going to start with the standard 16 pixel scroll that uses only the first screen, and then so this one is actually the same as we saw in the previous one. So I'm going in steps of 1280, and I'm going through the scroll screen, and basically, until I'm at the last 16 pixels, then I'm going back to the top again. So that's the scroll we saw earlier. And for the 4 pixel, it is kind of similar. It's just, it looks a little bit more complicated because now I'm going in 100 steps, and for every step, I'm going to the scroll screen. But I am for every multiple of four, sorry, for every step in four, so when it's not divisible by four, I'm going to shift 64,000. So it will start at zero, then at the top of the next one, at the top of screen set three, and then at the top of set four. And then I'm going to also add the diff four. So every multiple of four, if it's a multiple of four, it's actually going back to the first scroll set, but shifted by 1280 pixels. So this would mean 0, 1, and 3, and 4, 0, 1, 2, and 3 will go to the set 1, 2, 3, and 4, And then at the fourth step, it's going back to screen one, but shifted by 16 pixels. And then this number will stay the same, but this number will increase again. So it will shift to the next few sets again, and so on and so on. So basically, I'm using the diff and mod routine that I also explained in part 25 it was. And of course, if this is too complicated for people to comprehend or too confusing, you can also just use an embedded for next loop, which I added here. And remember, I will be publishing this code, so this is all I'm going to explain for now. And as you can see, it's coming. Yeah, it's coming. Now it's still smooth scrolling, and I made the background black instead of white because it just looks a little bit nicer, but 16 pixels at a time. But if I press the spacebar, now we can see it's actually smooth scrolling 4 pixels at a time by using this pre-shifting. So I'm using the pre-shifting in the sense that I tell the shifter to look lower into the screen to create this upward scrolling illusion. And I'm also using the pre-shifting routine to create pre-shifted copies of the graphics to be able to actually do the smooth animation in smaller steps. That's what we saw here. And yeah, I think it's pretty cool that this is running in a full 60 frames per second. And remember, on a real SD, in a full 72 frames per second. So that's pretty cool. And of course, we can do the same for 2-pixel scrolling, which I can also, I will load that one as the last one, 2-pixel here. And of course, remember, for 4-pixel scroll, we already need 8 screens, like 4 sets of 2 screens. And for 2-pixel steps, we would need 16 screens if I would do a whole screen, which on a 1 megabyte machine, it would still work, because remember the animation in the beginning, that actually uses 20 screens in memory. But if you want to save a little bit of memory, we can actually create a scroll screen with a sort of shorter repeat pattern. Like, remember in the B-move video, I actually used a screen that is 480 pixels high. It's like a set of circles that are 80 pixels, and there are 6 sets of them, for which 5 are shown in screen. So we only need 8 screens of 480 pixels instead of 8 screens of 800 pixels. And that means instead of using like 500 kilobytes, I'm only using 300 kilobytes. So there is a saving of memory here. And I'm not going to show the code. It will be published in on my GitHub page. So and the principle is actually the same with the diff mod. Except for a diff and mod 4, I'm using a diff and mod 8 because I have more screens to horizontally shift to. But the principle is the same. And as you can see, this also looks smooth. I now have a more repeating pattern of 80 pixels high. And I can, if I want to, I can change the direction. I mean, it works in both directions. You just tell the shifter to move in a different direction. And I added that here just, I don't know, I felt like it. And wait. I think I have the key, a lot. And I created this last roll down transition because I liked it. And this is why the pre-drawing took so long. This is basically a screen I drew only with drawing lines using graph mode 3 and then going in circles and stuff. I just thought the effect was nice. So I felt like including it into this piece of code. But the end means also we've come to the end of this video because there's lots of other stuff you can do with shifting. Because now we are moving, creating the illusion of very smooth and small scrolling. But you can actually use it for any movement illusion that you want. These were the two I wanted to show. And you can also use pre-shifting within sprites. So you can you put one sprite over the other instead of having to shift it on screen. But I'm not going to show that in this video because it's also very cumbersome to code. But it's actually you can save a lot of time, especially in color when things get more complicated. We might get to that in the future. But this is for now the stuff I really wanted to show. And remember, because this scrolling takes hardly any CPU time at all, you can still move objects around on the screen. It still works. It's just it gets more complicated because putting the sprites there is really easy. But because I go through so many different screens, when I go back, the position of the sprite is actually from the sprite I did like 16 steps ago or 8 steps ago, which is quite some time. And of course, by then, also the screen will be shifted by 16 pixels. So the cleanup procedure may be a little bit more complicated. But in the end, it's just numbers with a fixed dependency on each other. So we should be able to figure that out. But again, I'm not going to do that in this video. Maybe in the future. This was just to show the principle of pre-shifting and mainly focused on vertical scrolling because it just looks really cool. And that's, just a cool method to use the ST's abundance of memory to our advantage for pre-shifting animations that the CPU and shifter just cannot do on their own. And in the next video, I intend to explore more different memory methods for moving objects around, so I hope to see you then. For now, I would like to thank you for watching.